my company is Bob Repair and Tow, Inc. And then my son, Jason Kirschbaum, and Josh Kirschbaum are actually taking the business over. Those pontoons will float 25,000 pounds apiece, and they're custom designed. And the gentleman's company would be Tom Clary, and it's Clary Lake Service here in our area. And the first pull we did, I was absolutely amazed at how easy it worked and how easy it assembled. I want to pin everything, but I need the pins plenty strong, plenty heavy, to where tweaking it and twisting the rig, we're not bending stuff. And he said, I know exactly how to do that, and his crew did a phenomenal job on building that rig.
It looked like a really slick outfit, I'll tell you.
That's why I could get U.S. Coast Guard approved, because that way I can operate on the Missouri River, any federal body of water. The rig is certified to where I can do that. And that's, I think, why my operation in the ice retrieval business is, and I'm not saying, Clayton, I'm not patting myself on the back, but there's no room for error. Safety is the number one key, and it's strived. I keep telling everybody, safety.
Absolutely.
Safety. You know, ice cleats on, life vests. Everybody I check before we get out, you got your life vests on, a float coat, and I can tell if the float coats are on, you know, of course. But
right.
If I don't see a float coat, they better have under their coverall coat a life jacket.
Right.
And then I look, ice cleats, yep.
And so then when you go out, you already, everybody's on the same card,
yep,
as to what the plan is.
You bet. Everybody knows exactly, okay, guys, Jason come up with the idea. I'll let Jason and Josh call the shots out there. And just to see, you know, how they're going to react, how they're going to do, something would happen to me. And I got to commend my son. They outfoxed the old man, because I was actually going to swing the trailer around and bring the back of the vehicle up so we could get the, you know, the debris angle straight, and then unhook the trailer and take it out. And then Jason came back and said, well, he said it's all foam, so that trailer is going to basically float. Other than it had a generator up front, so that's why it was lifting towards the front side. And then we had a frozen block on ice inside the fish shack, you know, that there's a little lot of weight there.
Right.
And I said, okay. I said, well, that's a good call. But I said, how are you going to bring it up? And then that's when he proceeded, my son Jason and Josh said, well, Dad, and we draw it out on paper, you know, well, I want lift here, put the points on here on the vehicle. But then after Jason explained to me, you know, and then I said, yeah, you're right, there's plenty of insulation. Then he opted, and I said, let's go for it. So we did.
Right.
And it worked.
Right. That's one of the things that you strive for is minimal damage on the recovery.
Yep. That's our motto, is minimal damage on the recovery and or damage free recovery, you know, other than what's done by the water and or when it broke through the ice, you know, that damage. Well, like this Mazda R9, we had never pulled one before. So we actually found a Mazda R9. I called Serge's office and I had him pull up an R9 Mazda who's got one in the county, and there's like 15 of them here in Dickinson County. So the night before we drove out, I called. In fact, one of them had done business with me a few years ago when he had his Honda. And I said, do you mind if we come out and look at your van? Because we want to get a point as to how it visually look. And then Jason, he has to go by feel. Because, you know, you can't bend down with all that scuba gear and actually look. Then he actually put his hand underneath there. And then I said, Jason, there's what you need to feel. And he'll say, yep, Dad, I got it. And then he'll go in like he's, okay, I got to stay about a foot from the tire and come straight in, and that's where I need to run my, you know, chain and or strap, whatever he's using. And then we'll do all four corners, and then he's familiar, and then we'll take a picture. And that's what we did out to Phil Menlo's garage on his vehicle. So that day, before he went in, he said, can I see the pictures of the front end? I said, sure. He said, oh, yeah. He said, I got to stay about 16, 18 inches away from the tire. I said, yep. Then you're going to feel that spot where you need to run that chain through that way. Or, you know, anything like that, to where we damage the vehicle any worse than what it is. Because that point is loaded with rocks down there. Unfortunately, where it's set down, it actually, just ahead of the fuel tank, a big boulder that right on the cross frame on the vehicle, and it didn't hit the fuel tank. Otherwise, we would have had a mess. That's another thing that we have. We have cleanup docks, they're called, for oil, gas, you know, any type of contamination, because you're going to have, you know, gasoline or diesel or power steering fluid, transmission fluid.
Whatever
so
leaks out.
We leave the body of water, we put the box in there and we clean it up. So we don't leave any trails of, you know, oil or any type of fluid out there.
I saw the men set the dead man off to the west of the...
Yeah, that was me. I actually was over there with Del. That was him and I doing that. And my one son, Josh, first mom, was over there too. And they're actually, they were all custom built. They're actually I-beams, to where, you know, they're never going to break.
You're right.
You know, Clayton, there's no room and no margin for error out there. I mean,
right.
You have to have a backup for a backup, because one flip and, you know, you could, you know, hurt somebody that you bought when.
And when you open the hole for the, where you lifted the car up out of, you push the ice back underneath the existing ice then?
Yep, and the reason being, if you look, there was some small pieces that we threw up in the ice, but there was one big chunk that was over there towards the left where I was at. We didn't put that there. That was sitting there from, you know, when that vehicle broke through. But we don't want a snowmobile to hit that, so that's why we shove them under.
Okay.
Now, that's the reason. Most of that's about it.
Right, and they also...
Go ahead.
They also all had life jackets on, I noticed.
You bet. What I have is, they're either float coats, and they're made by Stern, and or I have gummy suits. And gummy suits is what you see all the people that work in the North Atlantic on fishing vessels. They're an orange suit, and they'll keep you dry, and they're cold water. I have four of those, and I think I have six of the Stern's flotation vests, and I have numerous life jackets.
Okay.
And then I have underwater camera system. I have underwater communications with the divers when they're down. And I actually have the capability of videotaping down in the water, which we did out there at Pillsbury, for the simple reason there was some damage to the left corner of the vehicle. And the trailer was jackknifed. And the vehicle was actually facing east and west. And the trailer was facing north and south.
I noticed that.
I dropped the camera system down and took videos of it while I was on the bottom, so the insurance company, the guys,
you do that help, during,
you know, what we're getting into also.
You do that during the days previous?
Yep, well, we'd actually videotape that the day before, so we knew what we were getting into. This one out here, this Mazda van, it was about 2 foot from dropping off that rock shelf into 50 foot of water.
Yeah.
So if it would have moved ahead 2 feet, it'd have been down in 50 foot. Well,
yeah.
That's why we ended up putting that dead man winch, as you see over there on the back side of that trailer, and then we secured to the vehicle because we didn't want it to move off that shelf, because A, it was in neutral drive position, yet the transmission was, so it could easily flip. That's why we secured before we actually started to lift, because we didn't want it to move on, otherwise we'd be doing a deep water recovery. And then you got more damage because the pressure down at 50 foot, it isn't so bad, but 70 feet, it'll actually collapse the roof. It'll push down the roof.
I see.
Excuse me. I said to Kevin, you know, we need to upgrade because the pontoons are just about done. You know, they were getting leaks. They were having to patch them. And I said, we're not high enough. I said, these new vehicles. And I said, we need to invest in new pontoons, and we didn't want to ensure the cost of doing that. So I said, well, Kevin, you know, I own all the winches, all the safety equipment, the cameras, and everything. So I said, I'm going to break off and go on my own. That's when I got a hold of Tom Clary at Clary Lake Service. And he's the one that got a hold of a nautical engineer. And that's how we got the ball rolling on the pontoons that we have.
Okay.
And they work great. Plus, we have the capability of actually adding to the pontoons if we have to. In other words, we got a great big vehicle, then we can add to it and, you know, another set of tunes. And then also we have another set of framing. And then we have another rig that we use for snowmobile and ATV, which is considerably smaller, that we use for snowmobiles and ATV work.
I noticed you brought this out on the pontoons out onto the ice and then assembled the rig out there.
Yep. And it's very versatile. pole. They're made out of aluminum. But the way they're designed, and that was the engineer that designed it, they're compartmentized. And ice, as you all know, is like a razor. It'll slit a piece of aluminum just like nothing when you're trying to slide it on the ice. So they're compartmentized to where we slit a hole in one, and we did it here back, I've had it now 4 years, those pins. It was 2 years ago, actually, cut one. And the only thing it did was filled 1 2-foot section inside the pontoon with water, but we couldn't sink. And we were actually floating on that one, and we had to come up onto the ice. And it comes up relatively easy, and that was one of the issues that, you know, Kevin set up was they were round pontoons, and they didn't want to come up on the ice. You know, if we were in open water, well, these pontoons, they'd pop right up over it. I mean, but I actually cut one in the front section, and we filled up the water in that front section. But like I say, we can float 25,000 pounds of weight, full draft out of the water, 10 inches.
And so the shape of... The tapered shape of the pontoons on the front end will just allow it to come from floating in the water up. It can be winched right up onto the...
this is our problem. If we break through, you know, with the weight of the vehicle in open water, we always have the issue of trying to get back up on the ice. And so Tom, you know, visited with the engineer up there, and they come up, well, this is the pitch or angle you need to do. And God, it works great. I mean, it just is absolutely magnificent.
It really looked like
Clear Lake. Yeah, Clear Lake, we were floating over there with that pickup, and we hooked to the rig, and it popped right up out of the hole right onto the ice. And I said, well, we have to do start stop, because when it breaks the surface, we have to let the water come out of the vehicle. So we only, you know, we inch it, and then let off, inch it, you know, and bring it up slowly. So when I ended up having to buy it, custom-made winches from Warren Winch Company to the tune of about $6,300 a piece, and then I have to send them in every 2 years to be gone through, because that's one of the criteria with my insurance company on my winches, my cable, the diver's gear, all have to be sent in, all their tanks have to be rehydrated, and all their BCDs have to be retested for cold water, otherwise I can't get insurance. And then I have to send those certificates to them every 2 years.
Okay.
So it's pretty expensive to do ice recovery. Mm-hmm. Well, no, by our recovery operation, we are leaving on a trailer from the vehicle. I have a lot of equipment to do strictly ice recovery work. Usually I've got 14,000-pound winches, so like 10 times what I'd actually need to lift a vehicle.
That's
and,
great.
You know, a huge thing is I have all my guys go through a ice safety course, and we have one coming up here in February of this next month. And what that course does is put on by the state of Iowa Department of Natural Resources. Minnesota DNR is also involved in it. And it's a course to where they teach you about different composition of ice. You know, there's five different types of ice. There's good polycore black ice, you know, that's the old part of the rock you can drive a semi on, and then you have wave ice, and then you have what they call honeycomb ice. Of course, that usually shows up in the spring, late spring. And you have what they call ace ice is where it froze in layers, and it freezes completely, so there's air in between the layers.
I videoed up at Spirit Lake at Marble Beach Ramp yesterday, and that's exactly what the ice up there looked like. It was in layers.
That one we're going to do up on Spirit for the Burnstead boys is going to be a tough one, because we're not dealing with the good ice that we have on West. That's why, and one of my criteria, and I stick to this, and this happened to me at Clear Lake. We had moved about 8 foot here just a year ago, and we moved 8 foot ahead, and we had 2 inches of ice. So I thought, what the heck? So I dropped the camera down, and about 3 foot below the ice surface was a rock pile.
Oh.
And that's why it was thin, see? And so last Friday over there at Clear Lake, we actually ran into that same rock pile. I knew it was out in that area somewhere, but of course, you know, I didn't do a GPS on it. And they have a map of the lake. And that's another thing, when I arrive to an area that I'm not familiar with, I always ask for a bottom map.
Sure.
Of the body of water that we're on, showing the depth and kind of the bottom contour. The state of Iowa is extremely good about that. I mean, and a lot of the lakes in Minnesota, they are too. But we actually, at Clear Lake, we were out all probably just about a quarter of a mile from getting to the truck. Now, let's go 20, 25 foot here. We're so close. The wind was blowing, and I think deviate from what worked.
8 to 10 foot to lead your way out to the recovery area for your...
With orange paint, and then, you know, and then when I get out to the beam, one thing that I do when I set the tow truck up, and you've probably seen out there, maybe you did or didn't, but I drill test holes with the auger. And I go on each side of the tow truck, at the back of the tow truck, and in front. So I'm in a circle. And then I go clear through to where the water comes up through the hole after the auger. And then as I'm starting to winch, you know, I watch those holes. And when the water is going to rise, it'll come right up through the hole, you know, at the back one, and sometimes even the side hole. But as I back the pressure off, the water better recede. If the water stays and doesn't, that means the ice, we're on a floating pad. All ice is you're on a floating pad. That's all you're on. And then that's telling me that the ice is actually going down. And then, and I had that happen in three different cases. And then after we moved everything and had to move, trying to think, that was down at Brownsville. No, that was down by, we were down by South, what's that? Lake or reservoir down there in Fort Dodge, they flooded here a few years ago.
Oh, Brushy Creek, yes.
That's it, yeah. Yeah, that's where we ran into the scenario. I drilled the holes, we lifted the vehicle up, and we started to winch, and I was watching my pad holes, and the water came up, and then I just relieved the pressure on the winch momentarily, and the water stayed. I said, boys, we're in trouble. We got to move. This ice is going to, you know, it's going to split the circle on us. So we ended up having to jig snatch blocks, and then I moved the wrecker at a 90-degree angle to the rig, and then I drilled the test holes again, and we did a test pull on it, and the water came up on the ice, and then it receded when I backed up. I said, we're good to go. But had we stayed where we were at, I would have broke. I would have sunk, and we were on 60 inches of ice.
So
and with a little bit of a wave-type ice was there. But it was good ice. I mean, I can't say that it was good, you know, the good solid core stuff that I like to see, you know, that we have most of the states on our way. But sure as shooting, if we would have continued, I'm going off of what the people that put on the ice rescue classes and the people that, you know, have dealt with. And that's what they told me to do. And the first course I took was just myself, was about 18, well, let's see. It's been 20 years ago, and it was actually up at Thick Lake Chetek in Minnesota is where that class was put on. It was a weekend, and I never have forgot that, what that instructor said, and, you know, he was right. I mean, and he said, you're just on a floating path. That's all you are. That ice is something that I watch very, very closely.
So you can read the ice by the flow through your test holes around the site.
You bet. And then I have what they call it, the laser, and it actually, you shoot it along down the hole, and you start at the top of the ice, clean all the snow off. And it's actually a little miniature computer, but it's got a little red laser light. And then you follow that ice hole all the way down until you hit the water. But on this, it prints you a graph. And it'll tell you, this ice here is the density of it is this. This layer here, the density is this. And it breaks it down in every inch. And I go by that, by the Bible. I mean, and again, I'm kind of like all that bounty hunter they call them, the dog on TV. We
right.
Hold hands and we go out to our recovery first and we say the Our Father. Because the good Lord's always with us on that. And, you know,
that's,
he's been in some precarious situations to where
that's great.
Brought us through, you know.
I'll bet you have.
Not be without it.
So the hydraulics then that create the open water, now it looked like there was some open water to the north of you there yet.
There was a little spot, and I asked, in fact, Dave Nelson and Jason, and I said, you know, I wonder why that spot's out there a little bit. And Dave kind of thought, that either that is the end of the rock reef, you know what I'm saying, or, you know, there's just a soft spot out there and there's turbulence. You know, it could be a school of fish will do it, too. Up in Minnesota, the whole school of perch out there where this guy fell, his vehicle fell through. And as we found out later on, because we got up there about 2-3 days later, and we went out there and dropped the camera. And I kid you not, if there was one perch, there was 5,000 of them around that car. And supposedly the vegetation or something that was there, according to a couple of the avid fishermen, gosh, but supposedly that was a huge area for perch. And they were actually caused the ice to be thin with the movement of their, tails pulling back towards the sea. And it makes sense.
Yeah.
He said, boom, you put an outboard motor out there and turn it on and come back 3 hours later, you're going to have a bigger open hole.
Yeah. I know there's still two open areas that I saw over on Storm Lake the geese are keeping open.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah. Yeah, Storm Lake, we've been down there before and pulled. You know, and down there we have the issue of how much silt and mud. I mean, when they drop down, we got a huge problem with the divers. I mean, it's dig out and you lose your visibility, everything goes dark, you know, because
right.
It's further up, see? So.
Right. I didn't stick around, Bob, but after you're done then, do you flag the hole, or?
No. That's where the precarious that I've visited with attorneys, the state of Iowa, Iowa Department of Natural Resources, and Minnesota Department of Natural Resources, and they absolutely say do not mark that hole, because if you mark the hole, then you become responsible.
I see.
When anybody drives out on that ice, you're entering that ice on your own risk. But if I go out and I put big red flags up and orange paint around the hole, you know, do not drive here, right? Do not drive on the ice. Number one, it's not going to last very long. The first snow that comes in or wind. But then if they drive into it, then it becomes my problem because I leave, you know, marked it. But no, we leave the hole as it is, and that's it. I mean, the vehicle fell through, we don't mark it.
So that's just how the states.
That's how the don't mark that. He said you're gonna have the problem if somebody falls into it.
Yep, I can understand.
Well, okay, but I said I don't want anybody hurt, killed, drowned. He said Bob. He said they enter that ice knowing it's not a concrete highway. He said it's a risk. And he said they drive out there and fall in the hole. You did. It's not your problem.
Right.
But I would feel extremely bad.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, if something did have that.
Well, I sure appreciate your giving me all this information, Bob.
No, absolutely not a problem.